Meet Craig Sutton. Craig is the founder of Nosara Paradise Rentals in Costa Rica and also operates the most prestigious charter fishing fleet in the country. Fishing Nosara has built a reputation as the best fishing outfit in the entire country of Costa Rica. Craig has fished his whole life, and in 2010, he caught the largest black marlin in the history of Inside Sport Fishing Television. Recently, he was named top angler in the 2012 Ship of Fools tournament in Garza, Costa Rica. Craig built his first boat when he was 11, and he's never really stopped. His first public boat build, the Wanderer, garnered national attention and propelled the Fishing Nosara flagship to celebrity status before it even hit the water. The Wanderer established herself as the dominant boat in the area in 2010 and continues to lead the Fishing Nosara fleet in number of marlin releases and in overall trips. In 2012, the Fishing Nosara Build Team turned the boat building world on its ear by marrying the proven workhorse Panga boat hull to the fishing tools of a boat twice her size. The Explorer has completely redefined expectations of what a 26-foot boat is capable of, posting catch statistics that rival the flagship Wanderer. The Fishing Nosara Build Team must draw upon the lessons learned from the Wanderer and Explorer while striving for ways to improve on these formidable fishing platforms.
Captain Craig, good morning.
Morning, guys. How the world are you?
Well, that's outstanding. Now tell everybody about the Discoverer. That's going to be your new boat.
That's our new boat going to Costa Rica. It's another 30-foot T-craft. We're going to repair it, refit it, and convert it from a single-screw Cummins diesel boat to a bracket outboard four-stroke Yamaha boat.
Craig purchased the Slick Cricket from local boatman Earl Newton, and right off the bat, we knew she needed a lot of work. The cabin and decks showed lots of evidence of water intrusion, and the entire thing was held together with wood screws instead of proper nuts and bolts. The T-Craft hull is very popular with commercial fishermen up and down the Atlantic coast. And even though the company went defunct 20 years ago, you still see lots of T-crafts in marinas all over the East Coast. Still, the Slick Cricket has a long way to go before she can wear the colors of Fishing Nosara. Craig's announcement of the Discoverer project on the Florida Sportsman radio show coincided with their magazine's Dream Boat Build contest, where online forum users were challenged to match our efforts by starting their own boat projects. One lucky forum participant would win a trip to come fish with us in Costa Rica. It was up to the Fishing Nosara Build Team to lead the way on this project with the entire Florida fishing community watching. The only decent part of the boat was this Cummins B300 diesel power plant. But since Fishing Nosara exclusively uses outboard Yamahas, this motor was no good to us. Fortunately, Craig found a buyer for this motor in Massachusetts who was willing to come down to Florida and pick it up in a U-Haul. This left the team with only one day to pull the motor, so the clock was definitely ticking. Jack and Matt hit the ground running, moving quickly to remove the footer bolts and disconnect as many of the fuel delivery systems as possible from this diesel motor. The collar bolts around the transmission shaft were especially tricky.
All right, collar bolts, go. That is the satisfying sound of breaking something.
Yes. It is.
All right, seven to go.
Seven to go. We got it. We got it.
Oh, yeah, that's on. It's on there.
With the motor free and the transmission collar disconnected, it was time to hook up the chain and call in the big dog. This forklift routinely lifts 40-foot boats out of the water, so it had no trouble pulling this motor. It's certainly better than our last motor pull, which was done with the winch on a flatbed tow truck. Even with this massive improvement in lifting capability, there was still chance for disaster. One of the motor mounts was a bit stubborn, so Jack used a pry bar to redirect the motor while the forks pulled upwards. Hold on tight for this one.
Up!
It's a good thing Craig wasn't around to see that little move, but fortunately, the boat and the motor were unscathed. We finished the job by pulling out the transmission shaft and a bunch of filters, fuel regulators, and other diesel knickknacks for the motor's new owner. As for our project, we had to leave the empty hull in the marina for now. Craig took the money from the motor sale and immediately reinvested it in a new trailer and a new boat shop. Welcome to the new shop. Though it doesn't look very impressive right now, this 100 foot by 40 foot section of land will be the base of operations for the Discoverer project. Matt began the land reclamation project by clearing out 10, 15, 20 years worth of weeds and overgrowth. Jack and Matt built the superstructure out of 1-inch conduit and a 15 mil thick canvas. It's very important to use strong canvas for structures like this, especially in Florida where high winds, rain, and hurricane conditions are a real problem. Despite our total ignorance to these kinds of buildings coming into the project, we educated ourselves, figured it out, and are pretty proud of our result. This structure should withstand the demands of the Discoverer project and provide us years of good service down the road. One thing we are very knowledgeable of at Fishing Nosara is the need to have a good boat trailer. Here in America, we get spoiled by dry docks, public boat ramps, and winches that help us get our boats in and out of the water easily. In Costa Rica, launching and recovering a boat involves a beach launch and about 15 guys to help push the trailer in and out of the water. It's a very dangerous process and very scary to watch, especially when it's your boat floating on the back of that trailer. Because of this, Fishing Nosara exclusively uses Magic Tilt trailers. Now, anyone who's been to a boat show or fishing tournament where they're giving away a boat has seen a Magic Tilt. They are without a doubt the gold standard in trailer design and in construction strength. This 30-footer we received from Magic Tilt has extra heavy-duty springs, the fenders removed, and a hardened winch to help deal with the salty conditions of being completely submerged in Garza Bay. On July 25th, Craig and Matt took the new toy out to Fort George Island Marine to load up the Discoverer. But first, they decided to give it the little Craig Sutton strength test.
About 6 inches. Whoa!
We arrived at Fort George Island Marine in the afternoon and found it buzzing with activity like always. Our main man Marcus was there with the forklift and he took the slick cricket, aka the Discoverer, off of its rack for the last time. Today, we would need Marcus's expertise specifically to help us shoehorn this boat onto the trailer. You see, every boat and every trailer are made just a little different, and so it requires tight fitting and perfect realignment of your bumpers and the yoke of the trailer to make this thing fit the way it needs to. Marcus advised that we settle and align the nose of the boat first, then move the forks back and slowly let the boat down between the bumpers. This way, we wouldn't risk slamming the boat too far forwards while still being able to use the forklift to align the chimes of the hull with the bumpers on the trailer. Our first challenge came right here. The orange winch should be above the eye by several inches. You can see here how they almost hit each other. Thankfully, this winch is adjustable, and after briefly sizing up the situation, Craig found the best solution. Back the boat up a few inches, slide the hoist up, then drop the boat right where it needs to be.
Good, Marcus.
So do we. I never heard of no slick cricket.
There you go. Well, in my eyes, it's always been known as a slick cricket. Come on, I knew it back when.
We continued to work from front to back and came upon our next hurdle. This small rubber tooth was certainly not going to be enough to keep the hull from penetrating through and hitting the metal below. But sometimes the best solutions are the simplest ones, and a 1x4 piece of wood did the trick. Now, obviously, this isn't a final solution, but it was a quick enough fix to get us back on the job. The final obstacle in getting this boat on the road would be getting the hull to fit between the bumpers. Craig had taken precise measurements and had the bumpers set nearly where they needed to be. However, Marcus noticed that the inner chimes were sitting just on the lip where the carpet rolled over the edge. The solution here is to lift the boat back off the trailer, loosen the U-bolts that connect the bumpers to the subframe, and then use the good old-fashioned art of manhandling to get the bumpers where we need them to go. We set the boat back on the bumpers with the bolts still loose, so we can do one final test fit. Then, satisfied that the bumpers are in the right spot, Marcus lifts up the boat and we move in to tighten down the bolts. Now remember, our goal is to set the boat down nose first and then move backwards to the rear. To do this, we place wood blocks halfway up the hull to point the nose down. Then, as Marcus slides the forks back, we remove the wood blocks so she settles into her new chair.
Got it. That boat fit that trailer or what? I'm so worried about that.
Between building the new shop, fitting the new trailer, and getting rid of the old motor, it took us a little over 3 months to get to square one. We have the tools, we have the time. Now it's just time to find out if we have the talent to build the next great Costa Rica sport fishing vessel. Here we stand at the foot of a very tall mountain, the demolition of the Discoverer. The goal here is to strip all the external hardware, all the metal, and most of the interior accessories to get this boat down to a bare piece of fiberglass. We're going to start with the most obvious and most external element, the rub rail. Notice how easy it is to remove the rub rail. That's because the people who assembled this boat cut a lot of corners, including the use of through bolts with nuts and washers. Instead, this rub rail is attached with pointed wood screws. While that makes the original installation easy, it makes the final product very poor. The original rub rail on the Discoverer is a 1.5-inch piece of aluminum, and is about the cheapest rub rail you can buy. Now, you can get away with this in the United States, where we have nice marinas and docking facilities. But in Costa Rica, we rely on a panga boat to ferry customers and supplies to and from the beach. This means that little panga boat's knocking into your beautiful hull all day, every day. Here's an example of that panga boat paint getting scraped onto our rub rail. Trust me, this look gets old real fast. Plus, in Costa Rica, there is one other little thing that rub rails need to be tough enough to endure.
Look at the fish by the pointer, right? Yeah. Oh, you gotta get in there. God. Sorry, no le hagas porque lo arrastra.
So yeah, that cheap ass aluminum rub rail just ain't gonna cut it for us. Later on, when we get to rigging this boat, we'll use a 2 3/8-inch rubber rub rail with a rope insert. This is the toughest, most sturdiest, and best solution to the rub rail problem. Here we see where wood from an old dock has gotten into the screw head. This is just one more obstacle we have to overcome in order to make this old rub rail a distant memory. The first step is to clear the screw head with a metal dentist pick. Then use the manual screwdriver, as the head has become too worn out to risk breaking off with the electric. Man, are we having fun yet or what? Matt finished up the rub rail while Craig focused his efforts on the interior. Now, boats have a funny way of just accumulating junk over the years, and the Discoverer is no different. After digging through all the access panels and all the coverings, we found literally hundreds of pounds worth of just junk. Now, we boxed up some of this and sent it on to the guy who bought the motor from us, figuring he might be able to use some of the diesel regulators and gauges and wiring. But most of this stuff, straight to the dumpster. With all the trash cleared out of the boat, we could finally move on to the pieces we'll end up keeping. All of the wood trim around the cabinet doors and the cabin wall is useful. However, this is a time where it's important to have a good labeling and storage system. Otherwise, screws and nuts get mismatched with the wrong pieces, and you've got a real disaster on your hands. Granted, quite a few of these wood trim pieces are rotted beyond repair and will never see the ocean again. However, we keep these pieces for use down the line as patterns, making the job of replicating this cabin infinitely easier. By the end of the first day of demolition, we'd amassed a pile of junk almost as long as the Discoverer herself. Ideally, only about 5% of this stuff will make it back onto the boat. The rest of it's going to be used as patterns and eventually scrapped. I must say that we're feeling pretty good about our progress after only one day of demolition. Now granted, this boat wasn't put together that well, so it should come apart pretty easy. But so far, no big surprises. There are a few spots of the floor that seem a little bit soft, but we're not going to know how much water has actually intruded and rotted away at our depth until we drill some test holes and start cutting out bad pieces. Now, in all the episodes of the Discoverer project so far, we've had a couple of little uh-oh moments. And here on day two, Matt decided to have one of his own. Check out what happens when you combine a 6'6" ogre with something delicate like trying to remove the glass windshields. The port side window came off relatively easily, but the starboard side one was wedged in and it just wasn't coming loose. So Matt hit on the very horrible idea of trying to move the entire 3-segment window while it was connected. Let's see what happens. Ouch. The rest of the demolition went on without incident. And after a few days, we were ready to step back and start the long process of overhauling this hull into a boat. Now it's time to address this 6-inch wide exhaust port in the rear transom. For this tricky task, we turn to the most senior member of the FishingNosara Build Team, Captain Jack Weinman. Jack has 20 years experience as an ASC master mechanic and has several boat builds under his belt, including the Wanderer, Explorer, and Adventurer. As with all fiberglass repairs, 90% of the work is in the preparation, and the devil is certainly in the details. Jack uses an air-powered body saw to cut away the old fiberglass tube that ran from the exhaust manifold to the transom. With that out of the way, Jack switches to a die grinder and begins to remove excess material from around the hole. He also adds a 45-degree fared lip so that the forthcoming wooden plug will have a good secure spot. Now this all looks pretty easy standing outside the boat with a camera, but let's see what Jack was dealing with inside the boat. I'm pretty sure he's down there somewhere. Yep, there he is. Remember that at this point in time, we still haven't cleaned out the bilge. So Jack's lying in about an inch and a half of greasy black water as he contorts himself to get access to this hole. Jack wants to achieve uniform smoothness with this cutout, and the best way to tell with fiberglass is to give it the old hand test. You can feel rough spots better than you can see them when it comes to old fiberglass. Satisfied with the inside hole, Jack moves outside and repeats the process. At long last, the prep work is done and it's time to fill this hole. Jack and Charlie start by making a wooden plug out of marine plywood to fit the hole. Then they fare the area around it to accept fiberglass matting. They run a coat of resin to hold the plug in place, then add circular pieces of fiberglass matting one at a time to build up the low spot to match the depth of the transom. To finish this repair, Charlie adds fiberglass micro balloons to a batch of resin, creating this fiberglass paste. Once everything cures and dries, this area should be bulletproof. We repeat the process with the rest of the holes in the transom, and after a few days' work, you could say that we have a brand new butt on this boat. Captain Jack and his trusty angle grinder are at it again. This time, he's cutting an access hole into the fuel tank so we can see just how much 30-year-old diesel fuel we're gonna have to dispose of. The existing tanks are made out of 3/4-inch thick fiberglass, which means Jack has to be very careful not to throw a spark while grinding this piece out. This old fuel pickup is just one of the pieces we'll have to replicate on our new aluminum tanks. As for this old one, we got a perfect place for it. We called our good friends over at Independent Waste Oil, and they showed up with a pump-out trunk to dispose of the 200 plus gallons of old diesel fuel. Here's a handy tip. Once the tanks are about half empty, Jack raises the front of the boat about 30 degrees. This forces all the sludge and solid matter to the back of the tank where the scooper hose can get it. As soon as the waste oil truck was on its way, Jack went about the very difficult task of cutting out the fiberglass fuel tanks. Jack faced many difficult obstacles in removing these fuel tanks. First off, the 3/4-inch thick fiberglass doesn't take well to cutting tools, so Jack had to run a scoring line the entire length of the tank, slightly deepening it as he went. Also, the relatively low flash point of diesel vapor meant that a heavy-duty tool like a Sawzall would be unsafe in this situation. Lastly, these fuel tanks extend several feet forward of the shelves, meaning that a clean snatch and jerk from the top is out of the question. After completing his cut with the die grinder, Jack uses this pry bar to pull the top off the fuel tank. Jack discovered some stubborn foam underneath the shelving that was holding the fuel tank in place. He pulled all his flexible tricks to get under there and remove this troublesome piece of material. With the foam out of his way, Jack continues his cut around the lid of the fuel tank and prepares to remove the top for real this time. It's tempting to feel victorious at this moment, like you've accomplished something, but then you turn around and realize that this is only one of two fuel tanks and the entire process has to be repeated on the other side. That, and this is just the lid, underneath reveals the next set of obstacles. If this tank's gonna be cut into pieces small enough to fit out through the holes, then these baffles have to go. Let's take a look at Jack and Craig working on the starboard side baffles. Throughout this process, we've noticed that the floor underneath our feet is a little soft. The first step is to cut open this old front deck and see just how soft the wood underneath is. While Jack scraped out the front deck in preparation for its new wood, there were other carpentry projects going on. Craig and Carl built a weatherproof shed in the back of the boat shop to house all our tools. Charlie went to work on the starboard side of the Discoverer, fixing a hole where the bathroom pump out was. Then he proceeded below decks to build this fighting chair mount and the new floor for the rear of the cockpit. When we peeled back the top layer of fiberglass, most of this wood has rotted away to the point it's not even recognizable. The water intrusion on the deck is extreme. There's no way that this soft floor would last for any length of time. The little cubes of wood are random pieces that did not rot into oblivion. So this image should give you an idea of how much slop was sandwiched between the fiberglass of the deck. Our goal is to fabricate a new front deck out of 3/4 inch marine plywood and fiberglass it in place of the old rotted floor. Jack and Craig make a pattern out of butcher paper, then transfer that pattern onto a 1/8 inch piece of press board. The press board is rigid enough to simulate real wood, and we can grind and sand it to make it fit the hole. Once fitted, we can cut the expensive plywood and know that we're not making any mistakes. We discovered a problem when we completed the press board mock-up. The tip of the nose is 4'10" from the base of the cabin, and as you know, plywood comes in 4-foot wide sheets. This graphic illustrates the problem. Our only option would be to scab in a 10-inch wide piece to round out the nose, and somehow retain the strength of the wood in this particularly vulnerable point. Our friends at Hood Distribution searched far and wide and tracked down a beautiful 10-foot long by 5-foot wide piece of marine plywood. Now we can build the nose out of a single piece of wood, which will make it drastically stronger and the installation about a million times easier. Craig transferred the pattern to the marine plywood and cut the rough shape with a jigsaw. Then he sculpted the wood down to form with an air-powered DA armed with 180 grit paper. Craig continued by tapering the underside of the deck wood to mate with the tapered edge we created on the hull. The idea is to make a clean mating surface where the wood and the fiberglass transfer weight between each other with as much surface contact as possible. The final step was to flare the flat edge that mates with the cabin. Craig removes about a 1/4 inch of wood and takes care to make a smooth bevel at the edges. A similar amount of preparation went into the hole that will accept this new wood. Charlie carefully creates a 45 degree angled edge on both sides, the inner one to accept the new wood and the outer to give a good surface to allow the woven fiberglass to fold over. After sanding, we clean up all the debris with an air nozzle and then thoroughly wipe all surfaces with acetone. For the installation, Charlie laid down a thick layer of epoxy resin on the new deck wood and on the existing hull. We added a layer of standard 2-ounce fiberglass mat, then sandwiched that mat under the wood. To pull it all together, Charlie inserted wood screws through the top into plywood blocks that an assistant was holding below decks. This squeezed the fiberglass epoxy and plywood sandwich and pushed out any air pockets to the edges. After a day to cure, Charlie and Jack installed 2 layers of woven fiberglass mat. This extra strong weave of fiberglass is used in structural elements all over this boat. Once the woven roving had cured, Matt and Craig began the arduous process of shaping the nose and filling all the low spots with fiberglass resin. Some people would use Bondo or Duraglass to bring these low spots up to level, but we want to keep the construction on the Discoverer 100% fiberglass. Taking the time to keep it pure fiberglass now means that repairs down the road are going to be much more predictable. For the finish layer, Matt lays down 2 quarts of fiberglass resin and encases it in wax paper to create a flat surface. Once that's sanded flat, a final top coat of fiberglass resin and phenolic micro balloons create a surface as smooth as a dance floor. The new nose on the Discover is stronger than ever. Where before was soupy pieces of cubed wood, there's now an unbreakable sandwich of fiberglass mat, marine plywood, and epoxy resin that should definitely stand the test of time. We repeated this process with the side gunnels, the rear transom deck, the floor, and coated all these pieces with a final layer of micro balloon resin mix. Now that the Discover is sturdy as a rock, we're ready to begin the final preparations for painting. Eight months of demolition and preparation have led to this. It is time to paint the Discoverer. However, we are not using a single drop of paint. We're going to utilize gel coat for the entire boat. The reason for this harkens back to one of the craziest months in FishingNosara history. In September 2012, our flagship, the Wanderer, was in dire need of a new paint job. After 600 trips on the Pacific Ocean, her bright blue finish was now a dull shade of nothing. Good boat paint is not available anywhere in the entire country of Costa Rica, so we solved the problem the only way we knew how. We loaded up suitcases with paint supplies and ordered a few gallons of DuPont Emron to be shipped from the United States. For 2 weeks, we had all hands on deck to prepare the 31-footer for a fresh paint job. Then, disaster struck. Days passed as we waited for our paint to arrive. But the bad news was, it was never gonna make it. Our shipping agent failed to mark the package as hazardous, and therefore it was seized by the Costa Rican port authorities. FishingNosara is famous for taking a bad situation and turning it into a legendary result, and the repaint of the Wanderer had become a bad situation. With the new fishing season just around the corner and our boat unpainted and stripped, we were staring dead in the face of having to give people their money back, cancel trips, and other unspeakable consequences. The solution hit us like a bolt of lightning. Let's gel coat the entire boat. After all, every Tico boat you see gets an annual coat of gel coat slathered on with a brush, and you can buy the stuff at any hardware store in the country. Because it is so thick, gel coat is difficult to apply with a spray gun, but not impossible. It takes very careful control of the catalyst mixer and the thinner. We worked furiously to spray 20 gallons of gel coat in a 48-hour period, and miraculously, everything cured and got us another year of service out of this boat. More importantly, we had proven to the world that you can spray gel coat. If we could spray gel coat in a muddy patch of rainforest in the middle of the rainy season with a converted car paint gun, then certainly we can do it in our shops in Florida using the proper tools and proper materials. We relied on our friends at Fiberglass Coating to supply us with 15 gallons of gel coat with wax, all the strainers, cups, and paper products we would need, plus a pair of these handy gel coat cup guns. These guns are designed so that the material catalyzes in a disposable paper cup, not in the nozzle of the gun. This cuts down on cleanup time and reload time between doses. After several rounds of finish sanding and acetone wipe down, the hull was ready to be sprayed. Our friend Gino broke in the new equipment and applied the first round of wipe. He started at the nose, worked back through the cockpit, and then finished the rear transom deck. There is a thinner specifically formulated for this gel coat called Patch Booster, and by applying the properly measured amount, It made the gel coat lay down smooth and flat, just like high-end boat paint. We were feeling confident after watching Gino put down the first round of white gel coat that we decided to spray the blue by ourselves. It took a whole Saturday to paint the blue hull, but when we finished, we were blown away by the quality of the result. Once again, disaster struck. Our research had told us that gel coat naturally sets up at 20 mils thick. However, we used so much patch booster for the spray gun that it only set up to 6 mils thick. This means when we came around to sand it, we exposed bare spots in the fiberglass. We tried to tag in the bare spots with new gel coat, but unlike paint, new gel coat does not adhere to old gel coat. We went back to the drawing board by repainting the rear transom with 3 layers of gel coat. We did not use any patch booster on the first 2 coats. We reserved that for the final coat. The idea is that we get better thickness while still maintaining the smooth finish that patch booster can provide. This is clearly the way to go. I only wish we'd known that before we spent 3 weeks sanding our bad paint job. 1 month after our original paint job, the decision was made to sand it all off and try again. We did our best to apply the subsequent coats while the previous coat was still tacking up. The concept is that the curing process of the multiple layers of gel coat should all happen together. Furthermore, this initial thick application will provide a great base for future layers of gel coat in years to come. All told, the painting process took 2.5 months from start to finish, including the 1 month loss for the respray. If you really think about it, that's the nature of this kind of project. It's always a cycle of 2 steps forwards and 1 step back. But if you look back to the last 3 months, this was certainly a major step forward.
Glück an min med hand. Staro Rouge.
I'm Dave East, boating editor of Florida Sportsman. If you're familiar with the website in our forum area, well then you'll know a lot about this boat. If you're not, you really missed out on something. I'm here with Captain Charlie Phillips. He got involved in a build in our dream boat section of the forum. He posted pictures of his build, and through that, he won a trip with Craig Sutton at his beautiful resort called FishingNosara. We'll hear about here in just a second. How long did it take? It
took 6 months. So I bought the boat in January of 2012, got it to the builder February of 2012, and picked the boat up late June, 1st July 2012. Started fishing it then.
And the reason for doing the build is, one, obviously it saves you a lot of money, but two, you're able to get the boat custom built to just what you want rather than having to buy something a builder has already built.
Exactly. This is a working boat, so I wanted really the least amount of frills, the things to break that I was finding on all the recreational boats. So I was able to custom build a boat with everything I needed, with lots of extras, but without just add-ons that I didn't need at all.
Right, efficient, and save you some money in the process, and end up with a good solid platform for your business. Yeah. Well, somebody else who's in the middle of a build right now is Craig Sutton with FishingNosara, and they built one boat already, and you can follow their build on the forum, which is still in progress, on their second boat. And what Craig did is he wanted to do a contest and let people come there and see his facility. And so we had a contest where somebody that would post a build would win. Obviously, Captain Charlie won it. And Craig, tell us a little bit about your build and what you've experienced. And then obviously a lot about the resort, because I know we're both anxious to hear about it.
Well, the build, we're doing a 32-foot old T-craft. Came out of Titusville, Florida. An 84, and we're converting it from a single screw diesel into a bracket twin engine outboard Yamaha boat.
And this build will be used for your resort?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We'll ship it down to Costa Rica, and where it'll subsequently be plying the waters off Guanacaste and catching some of the biggest fish in the world.
Okay, well, now the contest that Charlie won, he gets to actually go down there and fish with you guys. Tell us a little bit about what he has to expect, and I'm dying to hear about it myself because I want to go.
Oh my gosh, Charlie won a big package. It's in one of our biggest houses, and it comes with a day of fishing. And we're a nature preserve vacation rentals. We started about 15 years ago, internet-based. The closest to the 600-foot drop of anywhere in Central America, we're 6 miles to it. And then plus it's unique, it's closest to the blue water. And
okay, and then some of the fishing that Charlie has to look forward to, tell us about that.
We ended up building our own boats and started building them about 5 years ago. We built the Wonder, which is an identical hull to the Discover that we're building now. And we brought the level of fishing up to comparable to anything in the U.S. And subsequently our catches went through the roof. We're on track to blow it out of the park this year on marlin and sailfish, and every year we keep catching more and more.
All right, well, we're going to be anxious to talk to you as soon as you get back and find out about the resort and how you guys did.
Okay.
Hi, Mr. Boat. Are you on the
end? Just go make sure you don't hit nothing. Please. And that's why we got a rub rail. So in case you rub into the fence a little bit.
High blood pressure in the boat shop today as Matt and Brian fitted the Discoverer on her trailer for a trip to Oasis Boatyards in St. Augustine. There she will be fitted for the transom bracket that will support our forthcoming Yamaha outboards. She looks great riding down the road. Now let's get her ready for the water. It's been a little weird looking out in the boat shop and seeing this. We took this opportunity to get the shop straightened up and pressure wash the last 18 months of fiberglass dust and gel coat residue off of the tent and the bodega. Meanwhile, Craig and Matt took a trip to St. Augustine to check on the progress at Oasis. Oasis Boatyards has built a reputation as one of the preeminent repair and restoration facilities in Northeast Florida. Seeing the Discoverer lined up with the other boats they have at this shop is certainly an awe-inspiring shock. Some of these boats are well over 60 years old. Some of them are powered by the wind, others by inboards. But when you look around, you realize that every boat is unique. Each of them has taken on the characteristics of their captains and the crews who've built them. As we soldier on this project, we always want to keep in mind that this boat is as much a part of us as it is just a pile of fiberglass and gel coat. The shops at Oasis Boatyards are 100 times nicer than our little hovel. We're used to scraping together enough extension cords and air hoses to get by, so it's a real shock to see how the pros operate. We learned a lot from our trip to Oasis Boatyards. Installing a transom is a challenge of geometry. The Discoverer is very flat in the bottom rear of the hull, which means that the leading edge of the transom has to be perfectly level with the bottom lip of the boat, otherwise the handling will be all screwy. Without the motors on hand, we needed to get careful measurements from a known good boat. Fortunately, the FishingNosara flagship Wanderer handles like a dream, so we made a quick call to the boys in Costa and had them measure the transom on the Discoverer's big sister. With our measurements in hand, John acquired the template from Stainless Marine and using a forklift and level drills, sunk four perfect holes into the transom. This bracket requires 18 bolts to securely mount to the transom. However, we asked that John only drill four so that we could drive this thing back to Jacksonville. This raised his eyebrows a little, but we're certain that of all the bolt holes on this boat, these are the ones that need to be epoxy sleeved the most. The Discoverer made it back home from her little field trip to St. Augustine safely, and Brian, Jamal, Matt, and the rest of the crew hopped in with both feet to get this thing ready for the water. When working with a hull like this, the biggest fear is that down the line, water will intrude between the fiberglass into the wood around all the bolt holes. Once that water gets into the wood, it's all over but the tears. To counter this, we use a process called epoxy sleeving. First, we drill the bolt hole to size, then we over-drill it about two drill bits bigger. We drilled all the holes and took this opportunity to let the transom air out and thoroughly dry. We left heat lamps on overnight to keep the evaporation on schedule. Then we backfill the large hole with epoxy and let it cure. Once it's settled in, we drill the hole back to the original size and install the nut and bolt as normal. The end result is a sleeve of waterproof, impenetrable epoxy around the bolt holes. After a day to cure, we fix the epoxy sleeve into place with a very thin layer of fiberglass mat. On the reverse side of the transom, there was also a huge amount of work going on. You can see here that Brian has sanded away the spots where we plan on installing our new live well. Notice the bare spots to the left and right of the live well. This is where we will install elbows in the corner to add strength to the floor to transom connection. This same connection is a concern below decks as well. So upon John's advice, we laid up an additional 5 layers of woven roving to make this area of the floor really strong. Now right here, the transom is almost ready to install. The holes have been epoxy sleeved and the mating surface on the transom has been roughed up. We had to custom cut these backing plates so that they'll fit around the bolts that lay inside the stringers. We installed all 18 nuts and bolts, complete with big fat fender washers, and we feel confident that the transom of the Discoverer will be bone dry for years to come. Most recently, we received our custom fuel tanks from Sunshine Marine Tanks in South Florida. How custom can a fuel tank be, you ask? Well, on this pair of 73-gallon tanks, the model name is Craig Sutton. That's pretty custom. We acquired 4-pound pore foam from our pals at Fiberglass Coating, and this stuff is a blast to work with. Once mixed, you have about 20 seconds before your cup overflows like a volcano. We secured the fuel tanks with pore foam, but it didn't expand quite as rapidly as we thought it would. So we added a bit more around the edges to really seal up this cavity. With the transom installed and all this strengthening work finished, it was time to turn our attention to the tower. Our boys over at Showboat Custom Coatings already got this thing shined up into light new conditions, so we gotta be careful not to ding this aluminum during the install. We enlisted a few of our neighbors from the auto garage next door for some extra hands on this lift. The tower is not really heavy, but it is awkward. Everybody breathed a little easier once the bolt holes lined up and the tower was secure. They say you can't build a strong house without building a strong foundation. Now that all the structural reinforcement is complete, we're ready to hang some motors on this thing and go catch us a fish. We're closing in on the finish line of the Discoverer project. Craig and Brian have moved full steam ahead on the cabin build. Remember that the cabin wood we pulled from the boat was rotten and horrible, meaning we would be fabricating these pieces whole. The only use for the old wood was patterns. Our new pal John at Oasis Boatyards turned us on to a sweet building product called Coosa Wood. It's a lightweight fiberglass board made 100% of resin and fiberglass. Although the resin-based Coosa is inherently waterproof, we are concerned that it needs more strength to stand up to the punishment of a full-time charter boat. Matt and Jamal undertook the time-intensive process of wrapping all the pieces in fiberglass mat and then gel coating them to a smooth white finish. Coosa wood was also used to build these support elbows in the rear transom and build out the pieces of the live well. The transom to floor connection has been a concern for us from the beginning. This area of the boat carries a lot of weight and stress on it, so we're taking extra steps to make sure it is super strong. Craig and Brian engineered this custom tackle locker. All the drawers are notched, so there's no steel rollers or hardware. No hardware means no chance of hardware failure. In addition to the four drawers, Brian built a system of cubby holes to hold loose items like fishing tackle, drink cups, camera cases, and more. While he was at it, he also built a slick paper towel holder mounted to an open top box for even more storage. For the bathroom door, Craig came up with a nifty way to cut the vent. We were going for the old outhouse crescent moon, but instead settled on a shape a little closer to the heart. Jamal has stayed focused on the details, like the door and trim wood for the cabin. Matt has been working below decks. Here we see that he's rolled a fresh coat of gray bilge paint to help beef up the gel coat. This should keep the bilge protected for many seasons. You can also see that we've built a complete network of plumbing and electrical underneath the floor of the Discoverer. All the lines are run through the arch to keep them up out of the water. And of course, everything is butt connected and waterproofed. Now remember, the original boat had a single motor and a single set of throttles. This presents a challenge when building the new console. We have to fit twice as many gauges into the same space. Behind the console is a completely different story. Because we want to have an operational upper helm station, we have to use these cumbersome switching plates to connect both sets of throttles and both sets of shifters to a single line going to the motors. We pre-assembled as much as we could before mounting it inside the cramped engineering closet. Everything fit just barely. Trust me, you couldn't fit another bolt or washer in this closet. We worked at a breakneck pace to finish up as many details as possible before taking the trip across town to hang the motors. We ordered a brand new pair of Yamaha F-150 four-strokes from our buddies over at Tidewater Boatworks. Jamie and his crew at Tidewater Boatworks have hung lots of motors. This installation presented some unique challenges. The lip on the upper part of our transom bracket meant that the upper bolt holes had to use 2-inch screws, while the lower bolt holes required longer screws. This is the kind of clearance issue that you don't discover until the motors are actually in place. Craig and Brian were on hand to assist hooking up the power lines, fuel hoses, and the installation of the fuel water separators. After a long day of work and with a lot of help from our friends at Tidewater Boatworks, our pair of 150s are hung and ready to fire. After nearly 2 years of work, it was time to finally see the Discoverer in the water.
I'm a drifter, a lonesome drifter. Got no place to call my own no more. I'm wanderer, a lonesome wanderer. Got no one to call my own no more. Got no strings to tie me down. Got no cause to hang around. What difference does it make which way I go? Got an empty feeling down inside. Still I need to stay alive. And who can tell what waits beyond this door? I'm drifting. Lonesome drifter. Got no one to call my own no more. Got no strings to tie me down. Got no cause to hang around. What difference does it make which way I go? And who can tell what waits beyond this road? I'm a drifter.
2 weeks after the first water test, we were back to the St. John's River for the final water test before shipping.
Well, I taught the weeping willow how to cry. And I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. And the tears I cried for that woman are gonna flood you, big river. And I'm gonna sit right here until I die. I met her accidentally in St. Paul, Minnesota. And it tore me up every time I heard a draw, southern draw. And then I heard my dream went back downstream, cavorting in Davenport. And I followed you, big river, when you called. Then you took me St. Louis later on down the river. A freighter said she's been here, but she's gone, boy, she's gone. I found her trail in Memphis. But she just walked up the bluff. She raised a few eyebrows and went on down low. Now won't you bat it down the Baton Rouge River Queen, rolling on. Take that woman on down to New Orleans, New Orleans. Go on, I've had enough, got my blues down on the bluff. She loves you, baby, river, more than me. For that woman, I'm gonna flood you, big river, and I'm gonna sit right here until I die.
Next stop to the Discoverer Project, Nosara, Costa Rica.
Before painting the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo had to first construct a massive scaffolding to allow him access to the ceiling without interfering with the chapel's daily use. He had to develop special wax models so he could study the lighting effects to be duplicated in the frescoes and come up with a special slow-drying plaster. He suffered constant deadline pressure from frustrated church officials and the Pope, who just wanted the ceiling finished. The work itself was uncomfortable and unending, with wet paint and plaster dripping in the face of the man who was not, after all, a painter, but a sculptor. Such challenges arise in all the great works of human imagination.
pienso que lo nuestro ya llegó a su fin. Se ha ido muriendo nuestro amor. No sé cómo decirte que lo nuestro se acabó. Cuando el amor se daña es difícil repararlo. Hay muchas heridas que no sanarán, que no sanarán.
Sure as you were born, they bought me a silk suit and put luggage in my hand. remember a T-bone steak, all the carne flying over to the Golden State. The pilot told us in 13 minutes he would set us at the terminal gate. Sweet low chariot, come down easy, taxi to the terminal zone. Cut your engines and cool your wings and let me make it to the telephone. Los Angeles, you made Norfolk, Virginia, died 1-4-10-09. Tell the folks back home, this is the promised land, cause the Pinnacle Boys on the line. In 13 minutes he would sit us at the terminal gate. A swing old chariot come down, he's a taxi to the terminal zone. Cut your engines and cool your wings and let me make it to the telephone. Los Angeles, you may know for Virginia died, what a 1409.
This moment was 2 years in the making, but in reality, it was our whole lifetimes in the making. All the disciplines and skills that were drawn upon by the FishingNosara Build Team are staggering in their numbers. It started with Craig's dream, but then it turned into all of our dreams. And yes, some of the dreams turned into nightmares, but we came through all the same. I wish I could count how many people told us that they'd seen 100 projects like this start, only to see 99 of them fail. The Discoverer Project proves that if you're motivated and have a goal, you can persevere and you can finish. It's an immense feeling of pride and accomplishment to see the new battleship floating in Garza Bay.